Thank you, Vasant, for your introduction. Before getting into the topic, let me explain the objective of today's presentation. Today, I'll be explaining about the analysis, interpretation, and indexing of the SAID pattern and the various parameters that we can extract from the SAID pattern. I will explain. So, coming to the diffraction, like in the left top corner, you can able to see a typical image of a diffraction pattern, the electron diffraction pattern. And for the beginners, you will be surprised, what is this regular, like diffraction spots, and what we can extract from this spots, and why we are seeing this kind of a diffraction spots. You'll be having a lot of questions in your mind. For answering that, this diffraction is it's a interference which is happening in the because of the wave nature of electron in the TEM instrument. So the people who never know about TEM, like the TEM basic, it will be having three components, like in the top will be having a electron gun. So there we can extract the electron from a low work function material, for example, thoriated tungsten. It is a low work function material. We can easily extract the electron from that. And the second part is the acceleration part, like where we can accelerate the electron using some high potential, typically in the range of 200 to 300 kilovolt. And the third part is the weaving chamber. There will be having a fluorescent screen. There we can able to visualize the diffraction pattern of this electron. So normally we cannot able to see this electron. So electron beam. Instead, we are having this fluorescent screen that will again emit in the form of visible radiation after observing this electron beam. So that's how, like, this electron diffraction is different from the X-ray diffraction and the neutron diffraction. There, the diffraction pattern is forming on the same side, on the same side of the diffraction surface. But here in the TEM electron diffraction, the electron is transmitted through this material, and the diffraction is happening on the other side. So like we are able to like extract most information, crystallographic information, like whether the crystalline, whether the sample is crystalline or amorphous, or how this grain morphology and the grain size is distributed. Like, is that a monocrystalline, or like, is there any number of phases? How many number of phases is present in the nano range? Normally in the X-ray diffraction, you can able to see the phases, but in the form of bulk. But in a nano range, if you're going, like, we'll be having phases in the nano regions. So that tiny nano phases we can able to extract. Like people who are working in the thin films, they will be quoting the heterostructures. The people who are working in the photovoltaic, solar photovoltaics, they are having this N layer, P layer, intermediate layer, anti-reflecting layer, and this protective layer. So they want to see the interfaces, how the interfaces is having any diffusion in the faces, or how the interfaces is aligned. Is this properly, like, is there any dislocation in the crystals? So these are the information we need to extract from the diffraction pattern. And, you know, like, we are using this electron beam for, because electron is having the shortest wavelength comparing to the X-ray. The wavelength will be in the range of picometer, and again it is depend on the energy accelerating voltage. So we can go the minimum of a few picometer range of wavelength. So with that, like, our Everett sphere that we are going to develop in this diffraction plane is large. So with that, we can able to extract more information, and this electrons are scattered more strongly comparing to the other X-rays and neutron. So and like we having different scattering theories, like we our electron will be get scattered by the electron scattering, and the that will be the scatter angle will be less for electron scattering, and if it is scattered with the nucleus, then the scattering angle will be more. So and here we are focusing, like, here in this talk we are going to focus only on the analysis part. So I'm not going to explain much detail about the theoretical scattering part. And this electron beams are easily directed, like, for example, using the electromagnetic lenses, you can easily able to direct the beam. You can converge the beam or you can diverge the beam. For example, if you want to see the interfaces in the nano range, you can converge the beam and you can able to see probe it locally, like you can get the phase information locally. And the main, like, major thing is we can say by looking at the diffraction pattern whether the sample is crystalline or amorphous, it is monocrystalline, or how the grain morphology is distributed. Is there grain size extended throughout the crystal like a form of monocrystalline? All this information we can extract from this diffraction pattern. And in the diffraction, we are dealing in the reciprocal lattice space. So here, in this image, I have shown a few examples of the diffraction wave function, like wave vector. So for indexing the diffraction pattern, you need to know about the reciprocal lattice space. So reciprocal lattice space, and again, the kinematical theory of electron diffraction also you should know before entering into the indexing of diffraction pattern. So in this sphere B, you can see there is a single diffraction point, and you can see the small k is the wave normal of the incident beam, and here is the wave normal of the diffraction beam kd. And the diffraction vector K, the capital K, will be given by this equation Ki minus Kd. And from the scattering theory, we know the magnitude of this Ki will be 1 by lambda. So from that, we can calculate, like, by substituting that, we can calculate the magnitude will be equal to 2 sin theta by lambda. And, you know, like here, this diffraction condition will be different from the Bragg diffraction condition, because like here, there it is reflected, here it is transmitted. So here, like in this diffraction condition, is called Laveau condition, and the diffraction vector K, if it is matches with the reciprocal lattice G HKL, then the diffraction pattern will occur. So this image on the right, right side image, you can able to see that two diffraction point, and P1 and P2 are the normal of this two diffraction point, and R1 and R2 are the two incident wave, and again it is getting diffracted by the presence of this two diffraction spot, and there is a path difference AC and plus CD, like this is the path difference between this two wave. And if the path difference is the integral multiple of n lambda, then we can say it is a constructive interference. So once if that condition is satisfied, you will be getting the diffraction pattern. So if you're looking at the diffraction pattern, you will be able to get different types of these patterns, like in the, as you see in the image A, it's a diffuse ring. It is a diffraction pattern of an amorphous carbon. So like if you're having amorphous material, then the diffraction, this is the signature or the fingerprint of the material. And you can calculate the intensity profile with respect to the scattering angle. If you are taking the intensity profile, you will be getting a plot like this, as you are seeing in the right side of this image. So from this intensity profile, you can able to calculate this pair distribution function. It's a very powerful tool for the amorphous material. Particularly those who are working in the glassy material or amorphous, this pair distribution function is the probability of finding an atom at a position R with respect to another atom. So it's a very powerful tool, PDF. For that, we need this intensity profile. And again, like for calculating the pair distribution function, they are going for Newton diffraction and X-ray diffraction using the synchrotron X-ray. And along with that, we can able to calculate that, extract the parameters of lattice position with this intensity profile. And again, in the image C, you can able to see the polycrystalline material of a gold specimen. You can see the concentric rings here. And the image D is a typical example of a single crystal. There the lattice arrangements are extended throughout the crystal lattice planes. And here, this is the schematic representation of the formation of these different spots. Here you can see if the regular arrangement throughout the lattice plane, then we'll be getting a regular spots, like a regular arrangement of spots. And if you have a few grains, then it is having multiple number of spots, and it is again like it is merging up to form a circle. And again, like if you are having more number of grains in your sample, then you'll all these spots will be merged up and it will be form as a concentric rings. On the right side, the top image, you can see diffraction pattern. These are the this exotic diffraction pattern of a cylindrical lattice, and the bottom one is for the quasicrystal. So from this diffraction spot, we can extract the information of amorphous nature or the crystalline nature. What is the distribution of these grains, whether it is, and again, the distribution of grain is based on how you are selecting the area. You can select the area by using a selected area aperture. Like we have one in TEM instrument, we'll be having one aperture for selecting the area. So with that, we can go a minimum of 40 nanometer. So within the 40 nanometer, like if a complete grain is there, like then we can able to get a single crystalline nature. So within 40 nanometer range, if you have multiple number of grains, then we will be getting this concentric rings. So again, like based on how you're selecting the area. So even in the image C, you can able to see the concentric rings. So you can able to get the single crystal nature if you are using this converged beam diffraction. There is one mode in the TEM called converged beam electron diffraction. With that, like we can converge the beam in the form in a typical 4 to 5 nanometer range. So if you are focusing in such a very small area, then like there will be a, we will be focusing on a single grain. So we will be getting the regular spot arrangement even for the polycrystalline material. So I will be showing an example in the end of in the later slides, and you can calculate the ring radius using this formula. Ring radius will be equal to lambda L by D, and L is the camera constant or camera length, and D is the D spacing of the crystal. Using this, we can calculate the ring radius. And one more important thing we have to know is the zero order Lavoisier zone. So this is the highly symmetrical arrangement we can get using this tilting. We have
regular spot arrangement even for the polycrystalline material. So I will be showing you example in the end of the later slides.
Alpha angle. So with that, like we can come to a
and you can
symmetrical space. This is the perfect symmetrical first zero order Lavoisier zone. And if you are interested in going to a particular zone, for example 100 zone or 001 zone, you can tell the operator so that like he can tilt the sample and he can go to the particular zone and he can get the diffraction image at the particular zone. So like in for example in ferroelectric materials and all, like they will be interested in seeing the crystal structure in a particular zone, 00 zone or 100 zone. So they will be taking the zone axis there, particular zone axis there, by tilting the sample, and they can capture the diffraction spot. And like if you're not giving any predefined information, if you're not giving any suggestion like this particular zone axis, they can go to the zero order Lavoisier zone and they will take the diffraction here. Normally, all the diffraction you are seeing is the high symmetric plane of zero order Lavoisier zone. And these are the example of how the diffraction pattern is occurring if you are having the lattice planes like this. Like if you are having 100 plane and you will be getting the diffraction pattern like this, and always you'll be getting the information in the inverse space. So for example here the lattice constant B is 5 angstrom and the A is 3 angstrom. And by using the translation operation, you can able to calculate the consecutive points, and it will be 1/3 angstrom because it is in the inverse space. And again, 1010 plane, it will be again similar because the B lattice parameter B is 5 angstrom. So that like if you are using your translation operator, it's an inverse space, so it will be 1/5 angstrom. And you can able to find the next spot in the same by using this translation operation. And if you have, if in this diffraction spots, if you are able to calculate two lattice planes by using vector addition, you can able to index all these spots. So I will be explaining in the coming slides about the vector addition. And again, zone axis, like if you're having two planes of H1K1L1, if you have two planes, and you can calculate the zone axis by using this matrix. The zone axis is UVW, and you can calculate the zone axis by this equation, and always this condition will be satisfied. The this HU plus KV plus LW will be always equal to zero. By this condition, you can calculate this zone axis using this formula. This U will be equal to K1 L2 minus K2 L1. Using this formula, you can calculate the zone axis. So keep this in mind, or not just note this, because like in the last example, we are going to solve the zone axis using this particular equation. And coming to the addition rule, if you're having any lattice points here, inverse lattice points, and you can able to calculate the next point by using addition. So that is like here, this is the inverse lattice space GH1K1L1 plus GH2K2L2. You can calculate the next vector point here by just adding the GH1 plus H2, K1 plus K2 and L1 plus L2. So with that, we can calculate the new lattice point here. So this is just a vector addition. And coming to the structure factor rule, like if you are calculating this lattice planes, you have to know what are the planes we have to forbidden and what are the planes that we have to eliminate by using with the help of structure rule. For example, in the case of BCC, we know the lattice planes HKL, the addition of the HKL will be always even. But in the case of FCC, this HKL will be either odd, or all this HK or L will be either odd or even. So with this structure factor rule, we can eliminate the forbidden vectors. So we need to have the predefined knowledge of this structure factor rule. And for example, I'm taking this as a base point. Let me show the pointer. This is the base point, and these are the two lattice point I have chosen, and I can calculate the vector R1 and R2, and I can able to calculate this theta using this image software. So if you have information using this formula, you can calculate the lattice planes by using the ratio method. So what I am explaining today is a ideal condition, ideal crystal, but in a practical situation, practical condition, your crystal will be having lot of defects and dislocations. And for that case, the intensity of the spots will be varying, or you'll be getting some twin crystal effect, because of the thickness variation, you'll be getting some additional spots. So that is not in the scope of today's presentation. Today I will be explaining only indexing the ideal crystal. For example, you have defect-free crystals and you are having the diffraction spot of that. How to indexing that, I will be explaining today. So for that other case, for the defect-based crystal or thickness-based diffraction pattern, you need to know the theoretical background of different scattering theories, and you need to know about the different diffraction condition. There will be multiple diffraction, and because of the thickness, if you can segment the crystal into half, and there will be multiple diffraction which has happened, and secondary diffraction will be happening. So that will be not in the scope of today's presentation. That I will be covering the next presentation. So here, this radius, ring radius, will be equal to the camera length times the lambda wavelength divided by the lattice parameter d. So and again, d will be equal to a by root of h square plus k square plus l square. By substituting that, you can take the ratio. So this is a very important thing here. We're going to take the ratio of R1 and R2. So if you're taking the ratio of R1 and R2, and you know the ring radius will be inversely proportional to the the lattice parameter d, the d spacing. So it will be inversely proportional because of it is in the inverse lattice space. So R1 will be equal to D2 here. And you can calculate the angle between these two vector by using this equation, H1, H2 plus K1, K2 plus L1, L2 divided by root of H1 square plus K1 square plus L1 square
and again h2 square plus k2 square plus l2 square. This equation you should remember in mind, keep it in mind, because in the example problems we are going to use these equations. And okay, this is the typical example of the diffractions part, and you'll be getting a 0, 0, 0 diffraction. It's a direct beam, and after getting diffracted, like, you'll be getting a spot here. So that is correspond to a HKL plane, and this is the camera length L. That is the distance between the specimen and the viewing chamber or the screen. So that is the camera length. So normally in the TEM instrument, this camera length is pre-calibrated, and they will be giving the values in the reciprocal way, like the ring radius will be inversely proportional to the d spacing. So that is the relation, like, normally in the image you'll be getting in the form of the scale bar. And I think this I already explained. So for polycrystalline material which is having weakly texture, so the material which is having weakly texture, they will be having this kind of spots. It is not continuous spots, some discrete spots you will be able to get, and if you're having more number of grains, you will be getting a continuous spot, and if you're having amorphous material, you will be getting a diffused ring. These are all the example of polycrystalline material. And these are all the example for weakly textured material. And if you're having strongly textured material, for example, the thin film, people will go for some surface modification. And for that type of material, you'll be getting the diffractions pattern. In that diffraction pattern, you'll be having some spots will be missing. Here in this diffraction spot, you can see there are a few spots missing. This is because of the strong texture of the sample, and again here the diffraction spot is in the form of oval, slightly oblate shape. So that again because of the surface texture. So by looking at the diffraction pattern, you should know like the surface texture and the nature of the material. And here is the example of analysis of the polycrystalline material. And here I have explained the step-by-step manner. For example, if you are getting this diffraction ring, what you have to do is, first step is you have to use the image software, and then you have to predefine the scale bar, and you'll be having the scale bar in the range of inverse lattice space, right? 1 by nanometer or 1 by angstrom. So you have to first calibrate the scale. You should calibrate the scale. And then what you have to do is, second step is measure the radius of the ring. The ring radius you have to measure from the center point. You can either make a cross wire like this for calculating the center point, or you can calculate the, like, you can, in image J there will be option called circle. Using that, like, you can form a circle, and you can calculate the circumference. From the circumference 2 pi r, you can calculate radius. That is a effective method for calculating the radius of the ring. So you can calculate the radius of different rings here. And if your material is a FCC material, or if your material is a BCC material, you know that predefined knowledge, right? So with that structure factor, you can list down the allowed HKL planes. Like, for example, you'll be having XRD pattern before this TEM measurement. Then we know the HKL planes, like, that is present, dominant HKL planes, which are already there in the sample. So you can list down the allowed HKL planes here. You can make a table like this, and you can calculate the ring diameter. This is the ring diameter. So this is 2R ring diameter. So for three different rings, like, for example, like in here, four different rings, I can mention, like, the ring radius, sorry, ring diameter. And then you can go for, you can divide it by 2, and you can go for ring radius. And again, you can calculate the ratio of the radius. I mentioned here diameter. You can calculate the ratio of the radius. It's wrong, actually. It is not diameter, it's radius. The ratio of the radius you can calculate, which is nothing but 16.5 divided by 16.5, which is 19.1 divided by 16.5, which will be this value. And you can calculate the ratio. Why I'm asking you to calculate the ratio? Because, like, here we need to know the R1 by R2 value. So if you know the R1 and R2 value, with this defined HKL, you can match with this D2 by D1 ratio, and you can able to easily find the HKL plane. Okay, so
The first thing is calculate the ring radius, and you can take the ratio of the ring radius, and you can plot as a shape table. And you, the second table, you can write down the allowed HKL plane, and you take the square root of this allowed HKL plane, and take the ratio of the square root of the allowed HKL planes. Then you will be getting a ratio of this square root of H2K to L2. Then 1.732 divided by 1.732 1, and again 2 divided by 1.732, you will be getting this value 1.1570. So you'll be getting a ratio of this D2 by D1, and again in the left side you will be getting the ratio of this R1 by R2 that we are getting from this diffraction ring. So now you can match this value. So you'll be having a database of this allowed HKL and the ratios on the right hand side, and left hand side you'll be having your values like of your R1 by R2 ratio. With that, you can match it and you can able to identify the HKL values. For example, this ring R1, for example, this ring R1 is matching, the ratio of the diameter is matching with the ratio of this H square, K square, L square. Then my allowed this reflection will be 111. So this is 111 plane. So with that, we can match the ring. This is how we can measure the indexing the diffraction pattern of a ring. And you know, like if you are not having any predefined idea of this HKL plane, then you can refer this ASTM handbook or ICC PDF, like you have this JC PDF cards. Using that, like you can able to get this HKL plane, and you can able to get the ratio, and you can match it, and you can index the diffraction ring. So this is as simple as that. Like polycrystalline ring material rings, if you're just having a ring, then the analyzing, it is very simple. Take the ratio, this is a ratio method, take the ratio and you can match with the allowed HKL, and you can index the HKL planes. Now coming to the single crystalline pattern, for example, you're having a diffraction pattern like this. So how we can index this diffraction pattern? So for that, like again, the similar step-by-step procedure I have given here. So the first step, here you'll be having a scale bar, calibrate the scale bar using this ImageSay software. So I will show you an example of doing that using my ImageSay. Let me share my screen. Is my screen visible, Vasant? Yeah, okay, thank you. So I can open my SAD pattern here. And this is the ImageSay software. For the beginners, you can download it from the, it's a open source software. It's a it's a software you can able to analyze this SEM and TEM samples. And I have show an oval circular, already explained you about the circle symbol, right? So you can put a circle here and on the top of the ring, and you can calculate the area. If you're using this control M, then you can, the screen will come and you can able to calculate the area. With that area, you can able to calculate the radius. That is one method for calculating the radius of the ring. So what you have to do is, first you have to go to the scale bar. This is the scale bar, and you can set the scale bar here. So this is just for the beginners. I think already the people who already worked in this TEM know this better. You can go to the analyze, set scale, and you can give the known distances too. And the unit of length is 1 by nanometer. It's in the inverse lattice space. So now it is calibrated with this image. So what you have to do is, so let me go to the slide now. So first thing is calibrate the scale bar. You have to measure using the ImageSay software. That is the first step. And the second step, you can select any two vector points or lattice points. For example, in my case, so I'm choosing this as a base point, lattice point. So with respect to that, I can measure the distance between these two points. So what I can do is, I can measure the value of this by control M. So I will be getting one R1 value, and I can again I can measure the point, lattice point from here to here. Control M, again I can measure it. This is R2. So now what I have to do is I have to measure the angle between these two vectors. So here we are having an option called for measuring angle. Here this is the option for measuring the angle. So I can measure the angle with this. So I can measure the angle. So it is near exactly 90. So I can say it is, the angle is 90 degree. It is some form of cubic crystalline material minus a BCC material. So I can able to get this angle 90 degree. So with this, we can, yes. Okay. So I can use this option in the image J. We have one angle option here. With that, like I can click on a lattice point, like which angle I am going to measure. I can click there, and so this is the angle I am going to measure now. So with this, I can use Control M option, and the values will be coming here. Yeah. Or we can do one more thing, like on the screen, you can able to see the on the screen 90 point, like based on where we are keeping 90.87. So that is the angle. Yeah. In the image J software, it will be given, like the angle will be given. So this is the angle we have to measure. So this angle is very important because, like, for cross checking, you have three, four cross confirmation. For first is by the structure factor rule. So we can eliminate few points by the structure factor. And again, the final step, we have to use this angle. So I already said this cos theta will be equal to this one formula I have given. So with that, I have to check whether the angle is matching with the observed angle, like theoretical and observed angle, whether it is matching or not. So if it is not matching, then our selected planes is not actually, it is a forbidden plane. So with that, like, we have to solve. So coming to the presentation again. So what I have to do is I have to select two points. This is what I did now. Like, let me take the pointer. This is the pointer. So here, this is what I have done here. So I have choose two points. One is R1 and the next one is R2, only in the case of single crystal pattern. So I can able to measure this angle theta. So this is the only information we need. With that, we can solve the whole crystal structure. So using image J, we need R1, R2, and this theta value. Okay, so I will explain you how to solve this. So we are having, we have to choose two distinct spot, and always choose this spot as a non-coherent, like spots. For example, if you are saying R1 and R2 is same, then like try to maximum avoid that point. Try to take two different points so that R1 and R2 values are different. So and you can measure this R1 and R2 value, and you can measure the theta value, and again prepare the chart. Like as I said earlier, you can prepare the chart of finding the ratio, and you can calculate the R1 and R2 ratio for different values. Like, you can calculate the R1 and R2 ratio, and you can calculate the experimental angle using this image J, and you can calculate the theoretical angle using that formula, and you can finally you can able to index the whole diffraction pattern using the vector addition. So this is an example I have given here. So this is the lattice points here, and it is a FCC structure. And here you can see this I am taken as base point, and this distance is R1 vector, and this is R2 vector, and the angle between two is 90 degree. This is the predefined information I have. So I can able to calculate the R1 by R2 ratio. Okay, so you have to make a chart like this. So this is for different HKL values, and you can calculate the values here. This is the predefined value, And by measuring that, I can say this R1 is around 0.65 and R2 is 1.10. And I can calculate the ratio. My ratio is coming around 1.69. Okay. So, and my angle is 90 degree and my ratio is 1.69. This is the two information I have. And I know the crystal structure is FCC. And I'm saying this is for the ideal condition. If you are having any crystal structure defect or if you are doping with some material, then the value will be slightly different. It's not exactly to the ideal condition. It will be slightly varying. And in the case of highly defective materials, like you'll be getting some extra spots because of the twinning effect and slew angle. And there are many other parameters that is not in the scope of this presentation. So you can calculate the R1 by R2 value 1.69. And theta value is 90 degree. And we know the FCC structure allowed planes, right? 110, 200. It will be all odd or all even. HK, L will be all odd or all even. So 200 is all even, 111 is all odd, 220 is all even. So we know the set of allowed diffraction patterns, right? Planes, HKL planes. So with that, we can calculate the ratio here. And I can map the whole ratio and I can check 1.67 is matching with which value. Like I can see here it is like in the 200 plane, it is matching with two values and 100 it is matching with one value. So with that, like with that predefined value, I can able to identify these two points. This is 200 and this is 111. With that, we can able to identify it. So after identifying this two value, 220 and 111, I have to calculate this theta value. So I said it is 111, but it is mentioned minus 111. I will explain why it is like that. So after choosing this lattice values, like HKL values, I have to cross check with the theta value. So my theta is 90 degree, I know from the experimental calculation. So what I have to do is I have to use this equation, cos theta will be equal to H1K1. I know the HKL value, right? 200 and 111. With that, I can calculate theta. If the theta is not 90 degree, then you have to use the symmetry operation. So like, for example, it is if it is 111, it will be either minus 111 because of the cubic symmetry. So it is minus 220. Because of the cubic symmetry, the values will be changing. So we have to try all the other possible combination to get the value theta equal to 90. So once after getting these two values, which is obeying the structure factor and again the theta value, experimental and measured theta value, then that is our lattice plane, like minus 111 and 200. Now our job is very simple, like this is 000 and we know two values. By using this vector addition, I can able to calculate all this lattice planes by simple vector addition. So this is how we can calculate or spot the diffraction pattern for a crystalline, like our single crystal. And now one more thing is there, like for reporting in the paper, we should not just report the values. We should say in which zone axis actually this value we are observed. So for calculating the zone axis, now we know the two values, HKL and H1K1L1 and H2K2L2 we know. By substituting it here, 200 and minus 111, we can calculate the zone axis, that is UVW. So we can report for this FCC zone axis 1 minus 1, 2, we are observed this diffraction pattern and all the diffraction patterns are indexed. So this is how we can report in the literature, like in the journals. So this is the way for calculating the diffraction pattern. And for like normally, we are having a few softwares available, example Crystbox and some diffraction indexing softwares. You can cross check your value with that software also, like you can import the value and you can choose the crystallographic information file, SIF file. You can upload the file and it will give the indexed value of each spot. And you can cross check with that particular value also, like your observed one. And remember again, like this, whatever I explained is for the ideal condition. And in real situation, it won't be ideal like this. You'll be having some extra spots and you'll be having some weaker and dimmer spots. Some spot will be bigger, some spot will be smaller, and some spot will be more intense, some will be less. and that will be for each information we have different points. We can able to extract different points. So for that, you can refer the book Barry Kettler book Tim. This textbook which they have mentioned very clearly. So with this, I am stopping today's presentation, and I thank this DSR Decoding Scientific Research for providing me such a platform for discussion. So for any questions, I am happy to answer it now.
It's how to interpret SAED model patterns for orthorhombic and tetragonal structural planes. How do we distinguish the planes of orthorhombic and tetrahedral from the SAED patterns?
So for that, they will be going to a particular zone axis. I'm not very sure with this zone axis value, but they will be going to a particular zone axis. That is the symmetric axis for that particular crystal. So they will be going to that particular zone axis and they will look at the difference.
Okay.
So that's how I think they can easily able to distinguish the types of pattern if you are looking through the zone axis. From the zone axis. So that is again another scope of discussion that possible we can discuss in the next presentation.
Thank you.
Jacob, this is Dayanidhi.
Yeah.
Nice presentation.
Thank you.
Can you explain about the super lattice some more information?
Yeah, whatever I explained is for a ideal condition. For example, in your material, if you're having a super lattice, then you'll be getting a small additional peak. This additional peak, we doesn't know if you're away from the Lave zone and if you're just taking the diffraction, we doesn't know whether the diffraction is a super lattice or is that coming because of the different layer of thickness, different thickness of the material, or is there any defect of that point, the spot we are observing is coming from the defect, or that is very confusing, right? So that's why people will go to the zone axis. 100 will be having a particular fingerprint. Okay, this much spot and this is the brightness and this is the intensity. So if you are getting any additional peak on that particular point, then we can say, and again from the position of that spot, we can able to say it is a super lattice peak. So that is how people will identify that. I hope I answered your question.
Okay, yeah, you answered. Actually, I have one more doubt. Is there any intensity variation for a super lattice peak?
Yeah, obviously, intensity variation will be there. And again, there are softwares for capturing the intensity variation. And for example, if one of the phase is dominant in your material, there will be more intense comparing to the other. You can able to quantitatively measure the phase analysis using this intensity. There are some softwares available. I will check it and I will share it through this DSR.
Okay. And I have one more question. What is FFT and what is the difference between FFT and SAED?
Okay, FFT, for example, in this SAED having some limitation, we can't go less than 2 nanometer or 1 nanometer range. So, for example, if you want to get the diffraction pattern of a very small range of the order of 2 nanometer or less than 2 nanometer, on the surface of the nanoparticle, what is there in the surface of the nanoparticle. If you are having highly crystalline material, then the FFT, you can go for FFT. And this FFT is again giving the inverse lattice information. That is nothing but the diffraction information. So with that, I think we can able to use the image processing software. This FFT is a image processing thing. With that, we can able to get the inverse lattice information. Even in the nanometer, less than nanometer range, you can able to get the spots. With that, we can able to identify whether in your case, if you're having any PNR, you can able to calculate it using this.
PNR, we can calculate PNR.
Yeah, you can measure it. You can nano relaxer material and all, you can able to measure.
Okay. And I have one more doubt also. You talk about that PDF, pad distribution function.
Yeah.
How much close information we can get? Means that atomic level or?
It's a atomic level information. It's a, because like in normally this pair distribution function people will use only for the amorphous material. It won't be useful in a crystalline material. In an amorphous material, for example, how long the range of orderness is there? Like, for example, if you are normal in our crystalline material, the range of order will be in the more than 5 nanometer or 6 nanometer range. So we'll be having long range of orderness in our sample. But in a disordered sample, like how long it is having order? It will be in the range of 3 atomic layer of orderness. So such material, then like we can go for power distribution function. Using the intensity distribution with respect to the scattering angle, we can calculate the relative position, like which atom is present next to the position R with respect to the another atom. That information, normally people working in the glass material, so they are using this pair distribution function.
In perovskite also, there will be more disorder, no? So we can use
But in perovskite, I think there may be paper available if they are looking for nano range. If nano range disorderness is there in the sample, then you can go for this pair distribution function measurement.
Okay. Nano range disorder.
Disorders, yeah.
Thank you, Jacob. Yeah, well present.
Hello, Jacob.
Yes.
I'm Satish from chemistry.
Yeah, tell me.
Nice presentation. I have a few queries.
Yeah.
I am very new to this field, actually. So okay. I'm happy to thank DSR for this arranging this webinar. And my doubt is I'm working in molecular structures. So after seeing this presentation, I'm curious to know whether my perception is right or wrong. Most of the molecular structures will be analyzed only through NMR, mass, etc. They never go for the TIM analysis. But after seeing this, even the macromolecules and dendrim as huge molecular structures will have a nanoparticle size. If you take the size of the molecules, it will be like a nanoparticle or micro size.
Yeah.
In that case, I'm curious that why these people are still not explored for TIM in case of molecular structures.
Okay,
in the essence of nano is exactly the size and the morphology is influencing the application part, right? In that case, yes. Even the difference in the application efficiency in the application will depend on the size and morphology of even the molecular structures also. So whether taking the molecular structures into the TIM is right or wrong, that's my perception. Because still not explored much for the molecular structures, whether my perception is right or wrong, I'm very curious to know about that.
Okay, so in your case of molecular materials, I think the energy that we are giving in the TM is very high. It will be in the range of a few kilo electron volt. So like the energy is very high. So like I don't think it's possible to take measurement with that, because like instantly the material will get evaporate. If you're organic material and all, then we can go for some low energy TEM measurements. And again, we are keeping it in vacuum. Like that's why I think people are not much explored that material. And one more thing, like this TEM, we can able to get the information of crystalline material. If you're having amorphous material, you'll be getting this this diffused ring. So there won't be much information that we can extract from this TEM. That case, you can go for, I think, NMR or this mass is the better choice. Like if you're having a crystalline material or nano-range crystallinity in your material, then I think TEM is a better choice for extracting the crystallographic information point. So
doing single crystal XRD, right? We are doing a single crystal diffraction technique for confirmation of the structures. But in that also, they're using same type of rays, right? In that, it's not evaporating organic compounds. Why in TIM alone it's getting evaporated?
So if you're having a crystal, I think we can able to take it with the TEM measurement. So I'm saying in the form of liquid and organic material, it is, I need to know the nature of the material.
XRD.
Yes.
We already solved the single crystal XRD. So we have already confirmed the structures. So the size of the structures, if we know through TIM, means it is very useful to compare the efficiency in the application part.
Okay.
That's my question actually.
Okay, so if you're having a single crystal, then we can able to do it. Like normally, you'll be having the molecule and you'll be growing in the form of single crystal, right? For taking crystal diffraction.
Yeah.
So exactly. If you're having the single crystal, I think then it's possible to take TEM measurement. And if you know the like melting point and the parameters, then I think we can tune the energy. We can go for the low energy range and we can able to calculate the extract the crystallographic information. That is possible.
Okay. Thank you. Nice presentation.
Okay.
Jacob, there are two questions in the chat box. The
yes.
one was from Mr. Pandyarajan. So he says it is a very good presentation. And then the question is, on what basis we should choose the spots if we have different intensities in the diffraction pattern?
So,
I'll repeat it.
Like,
so on, on what basis we should choose the spots if we have different intensities in the diffraction pattern?
So you mean like for analyzing the diffraction pattern or while taking the measurement itself or like I don't
know. No, for analyzing I think he is specifying the analysis. So there are let's have an example that we have got 10 spots in it. So if we have 10 spots and there are difference in the intensities for the 5 spots and the other 5 spots are not intense. So in such cases, which group of spots
okay,
you should
so like
choose?
Okay, for intensity variation, I'm not sure about that spot choosing. Like still I'm exploring that part because like that is little complex. If you're having different intensity, like so in the next presentation I'll try to explain that. I don't know much about this intensity variation things.
Okay, that was nice, thank you. And there is the second question from Satya. It's like, in amorphous materials, if the material is in multiple phases, how SAED can be useful in interrupting it?
Okay, in SAED, you'll be getting different amorphous rings. That is the only information. Like, we won't be yet getting much information from the TEM in the range of amorphous material. We'll be getting some diffuse ring. We can say there is some diffuse ring is there, some amorphous material is there in the measurement. Like we can say only the amorphous nature of the material, and we can't quantitatively say what are the materials that present in the sample. For that, we need some other techniques like IDACs or some other things.
Oh, okay, thank you. So there is one more question on the chat box, which is for the hexagonal close packing, like HCP structure. Is it possible to calculate dislocation density on the particular orientation?
Yeah, it is. Obviously, it is possible, but I don't know how to do that. It is possible, and we can extract all the crystallographic information from this TEM measurement. So for that, I have to look into it. We can extract this dislocation densities, like all this information, we can able to extract it.
Okay, thank you. So there are a few follow-up questions. Like in case of SAED patterns obtained in is always in the form of reciprocal lattice, but whereas the TEM or HRTEM, whatever we is in the form of direct lattice Fourier transformation.
Yes. Yes.
So why does such thing happen? Why SAED is always in reciprocal and the other things are in direct lattice?
So in the kinematic vector theory, I have to explain for getting the extracting the information of the crystal space, like for the crystallographic information, inverse lattice space is the better option. So they have designed the theory in such a way, like for getting the maximum information from that. Like, and again, I already explained this difference vector k, or the diffraction vector k will be 1 by lambda. It will be in
yes.
the inverse. Space, right?
Yes.
So like from and again, like the conversion is very easy. The inverse lattice space of BCC, I think it will be like FCC, the inverse lattice space will be the BCC in the real space. Like there is conversion will be easiest. So the crystallographers, they normally prefer the inverse lattice space, and the conversion is easy. And again, the theory is follow-up theories, the Laue theory of such things are easiest. And again, the image we are getting is the real space. So the D value directly, like the D spacing, if you're having the lattice planes, you can calculate the D spacing by using the image J, and it is a direct D spacing. But in the reciprocal space, in the diffraction,
Image is on the direct lattice, but the scale is on the inverse lattice.
No, in image, it will be in the direct lattice.
Yes.
It will be in the angstrom or nanometer range. but only in the diffraction pattern it will be in the inverse 1 by nanometer or 1 by angstrom.
Okay, yes. I think there are, I have just two more questions with me. One is like, we know XRD is also a diffraction pattern, and then yeah. SEAD is also a diffraction pattern. So when we index both XRD and SAED, in most cases it won't match. Like, why it is so? Like, what makes it to be so different?
No, like, it is not like it, it should match, right? So
the indexed peak in TEM as well as in XRD will match?
Yeah, it will match. Like, but the symmetry operation will be there in the, like, for example, if it is 100 in the XRD plane, it will be minus 100 in the diffraction plane. So it will always match.
Fine. So there is one last question, like, how accurate will be the planes indexed by the SAED? Like, so we follow a lot of operations and then we index it.
Accuracy again, like I explained only 2 points to take, right, for R1 and R2 and calculating the theta.
Yes.
So what you have to do is you have to calculate multiple R1 values in different sites, and you can average it up, and like by that way you can enhance your accuracy.
Okay. I think we'll take one last question from the participants. If they have any question, like, we'll just take it. So I think I've got the one last question.
Yes.
It is like, all peaks we get from XRD cannot be obtained from SAED or TEM. So why there is a limitation in this?
No, like even like the peaks that we are not able to capture with the XRD, you can able to capture with SAED. So the SAED, again, like it's based on the operator, whether you are going for the inverse space, like it is 1 by 5 nanometer or 1 by 2 nanometer or 1 by 10 nanometer, based on that area, you can able to extract more information. So for example, if you are going for a very close range, your magnification is more, then you are measuring 1 by 2 nanometer, then I think your first 3 or 4 indents peak only will be visible in your diffraction ring. So, like, if you're going for 1 by 10, higher magnification range, you'll be able to get the diffraction pattern, more number comparing to the X-ray diffraction. So, it's again based on the operator, like, how he is taking and how you are communicating with the operator. That's all.
That was really a good explanation. Thank you so much. So, in case of no further questions, on behalf of all of us, I thank Mr. Jacob for accepting our invitation. Thank you, Mr. Jacob.
Thank you.
Yes. If you need any help in measuring or analyzing, or if you still have some doubts, you can feel free to contact Mr. Jacob through email. The email ID is given in the chat box as well. To get updates on such wonderful lectures, stay connected with us on Instagram. The Instagram and YouTube link is also given in the chat box. Once again, I thank you all and have a wonderful day. Thank you so much, Jacob, and thank you all participants.
Thank you.